This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, Greater Central. To God be the glory, to our pastor, Reverend Frank Hawkins, to Sister Brenda K. Foreman, our Christian Education Director, and to Sister Catherine Hill, our Superintendent of Sunday School. And to you all, to my sisters and brothers in Christ, I greet you in the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and with God's love. Amen. Amen. This morning we have a great lesson. Our lesson is on Ezra and the law. Our devotional reading is Ezra 7, 1 through 10, 23 to 26. And our background scripture is Ezra 7, 1 through 26. Let me just open up with a word of prayer. Father, we come, God, to your throne of grace this morning, God, thanking you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you, God, for all things, oh God. We thank you for this day that you've given us, oh God. Father, we come to study your word this morning, oh God. Father, you said, God, that if we study to show ourselves approved, we need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, oh God. That we ought to study, that God, we ask, oh God, that we study this morning, and we ask for your presence this morning, God, the Holy Spirit to teach, oh God, to guide this lesson, oh God. I pray this morning that each and every one of us will leave this morning with a word that will encourage us, oh God, a word that will change our lives, oh God, a word, oh God, that will bless our families, oh God. Father, we thank you, God, for everything, Lord God. So, Father, I pray for your anointing, God, on these airwaves, oh God, that you would anoint everyone at the sound of my voice, oh God. And I thank you, Holy Spirit, and I bless your name this morning. In Jesus' name I pray, amen and amen and amen. I give God again the glory and the honor. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the Lord on my side this morning. I wouldn't be sitting here if it wasn't for Jesus. So I give him praise for the opportunity this morning. And so today our lesson is on Ezra and the law. We have a key text here that's very important. Is Ezra 7 and 10. Ezra had devoted himself to the study and observance of the law of the Lord, and to the teachings of its decree and laws of Israel. Amen. Before I begin, can I get two readers? Ezra 7, 1 through 10, and Ezra 23 to 26. I do understand that some of these words are a little difficult. But can I get someone to read Ezra 7, 1 through 10? Okay.
Good morning, Sister Joni.
Good morning,
church family. I know the words are going to be a little difficult.
No, that's okay.
Good.
You okay?
It reads, Ezra, from 7 through 10, it reads, now after these things in the reign of Artaxerxes, the king of Persia, Ezra, the son of Seraiah, the son of Azariah, the son of Hilkiah, the son of Shalom, the son of Zadok, the son of Ashabtub, the son of Amariah, the son of Azariah, the son of Meriah, the son of Zariah, the son of Uzi, the son of Buki, the son of Abushua, the son of Phanela, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the chief of the priests. Now, this Ezra went up from Babylonia, and he was a ready scribe in the law of Moses. which the Lord God of Israel has given. And the king granted him all his requests according to the hand of the Lord his God upon him. And there went up some of the children from Israel, and of the priests and the Levites, and the singers and the porters, and the Nethims unto Jerusalem. And in the 7 years of Artaxerxes the king, and he came to Jerusalem in the fifth month, which was in the 7 year of the kings. And for upon the first day of the first month began he to go up from Babylonia. And on the first day of the first month he came, and he said to, and he said, and he to Jerusalem according to the good hand of his God upon him. For Ezra has prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord, and to do it, and to teach in Israel statute and judgment. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. You were reading the NIV.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Can we get a reader for 23 to 26? And I thank you, Sister Robinson, for accepting the challenge. For accepting the challenge. Can I get a reader for 23 to 26? Good morning.
Okay. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Evangelist Cooper.
Okay, good morning. I hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
Whatever the God of heaven has prescribed, let it be done with diligence for the temple of the God of heaven. Why should his wrath fall on the realm of the king and of his sons? You are also to know that you have no authority to impose taxes, tribute, or duty on any of the priests, Levites, musicians, gatekeepers, temple servants, or other workers at this house of God. As you, and you, Ezra, in accordance with the wisdom of your God, which you possess, appoint magistrates and judges to administer justice to all the people of Trans-Euphrates, all who know the laws of your God. And you are to teach any who do not know them. Whoever does not obey the law of your God and the law of the king must surely be punished by death, banishment, confiscation of property, or imprisonment.
Amen.
I just read, Ezra 23 through 26, the word of God for the people of God.
Amen, amen, amen. So we get, this book is about Ezra. And Ezra was commissioned on an assignment. I just want to give a biblical background so we can understand how he got to this point. The background, a little biblical background, is the Israelites were attacked and captured by the King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. The Babylonian army destroyed the temple and much of Jerusalem. And the Israelites spent 70 years living in Babylonian in captivity. God used the Babylonian as the agent of judgment against Israel for their sins of idolatry and rebellion against him. King Cyrus, the ruler of Persia, defeated Babylon, as God has said, as prophesied in the scriptures. The Jewish people would be allowed to return to Jerusalem after 70 years of exile. The prophecy was fulfilled in 537 BC, and the Jews were allowed by King Cyrus of Persia to return to Israel for rebuilding the city and the temple. It was under the rule of the Jews were first allowed to return to Israel after 70 years of captivity. And this is really important because we know that the Israelites, they were disobedient to God. And I just want to point out, you know, when we are disobedient, judgment can come upon us. And so what God did was he placed them in captivity for 70 years. King Cyrus decreed and supported the Israelites who chose to return back to their homeland. And there were three migrations of the Jews, the return from captivity in Babylon back to Judah and to Jerusalem. So there were three. The first was Zerubbabel, led the first return to Jerusalem in 536 BC. And he was instrumental in helping to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. The second is where we are now, Ezra. Ezra led a second group of Jewish exile from Babylonian to Jerusalem. Ezra's focus was on rebuilding the community and returning their hearts of the people of God back to him through the word of God. Amen. And the third person was Nehemiah. He was a cupbearer and trusted advisor of Artaxerxes, led the third return in 4040 BC. And was responsible, he was responsible for rebuilding Jerusalem walls and the outer defenses. Amen. So this week we're focusing on Azariah. Azariah, God's choice, God chose them. He led the people of Israel back from their homeland. And we'll see in chapter 7, and that's where we are. So I want you to look at chapter 7 because this chapter is very important. Ezra is the author of this book, but he doesn't come or appear on the scene until chapter 7 of this book. But he doesn't come. Okay, so in chapter 1 through 6, Ezra was writing about what had happened to other people before him in Israel and in Judah. Now, starting in chapter 7, he's writing about his own experiences, things that he personally witnessed as he led even the second return to Jerusalem to Judah. Amen. So we're going to look at verse 1. And that's just a little background, because when you read a chapter or a book like Ezra and you just go into reading it, there's so many things that took place prior that, and I didn't even touch on half of it, just a bit of it. But there's so many things that took place prior that will give us a little more understanding, and especially in the Old Testament, of what took place. So we're going to begin in Ezra chapter 7, and let's start with verse 1 through 5. So we can get a good understanding of what is going on. So here it says, after these things, during the reign of Artaxerxes, king of Persia, Ezra, son of Sariah, and son of Azariah, and son of Hilkiah, son of Shalom, son of Zadok, son of Apatab, son of Amariah, son of Zariah, son of Merthah, son of Zechariah, and son of Uriah, son of Bukka, son of Abishia, son of Phinehas, son of Eleazar, and son of Aaron, the chief priest. Stop. And I'm sorry if I messed up some of the words, but it's a tongue twister here. So here, verse 1 through 5, Azariah wants to establish his lineage. He wants to establish who he is and where he comes from. And we find that a lot within the Bible in different books, because for the Jews, it's very important to establish where they come from. So here we have, he was a descendant from Aaron. So we see here at the end where it says, the son of Aaron, the chief priest. So being that he was the son, and he wasn't the son, he comes from that line of Aaron, which allows him to be a priest, which allows him to be a priest. He shows his credentials to avoid any possible division with the people that he's bringing with him. Why? Because he's standing in a position of authority, and we'll see that as we go down into our reading. So I just assume he probably didn't want any challenges or conflict with the people in terms of who he was. So it was very important for Jews to, and the Israelites, to prove their identity as a Jew, to prove that their identity in the Levitical priesthood. Again, he was a priest. And so the priest can only be of a tribe of the Levi and a descendant of Aaron and a brother of Moses. So we do understand that his background showed who he was. Amen? So now we go to this Ezra came up from Babylon. He was a teacher, well-versed in the law of Moses, which the Lord, the God of Israel, had given. The king had granted him everything he asked. The king, and this was a pagan king, had granted him everything he asked for the hand of the Lord, which is a key word that we're going to see today. The hand of the Lord was upon him, right? His God was on him. So we see very clearly that he was a man chosen by God. Amen. We see that God, he was a God chosen man. He didn't go on his own. He didn't go because he wanted to go. He was chosen by God for this assignment. So here we have, again, he was a scribe. Ezra was a scribe, a teacher. He was considered an expert in the law. He studied carefully and memorized a large section of the law. His chief responsibility as a scribe was to copy the word letter by letter, book by book. Because remember, they didn't have copying machines back then. They didn't have anything to duplicate their copies. So it was very important for this person who's considered a scribe to be very careful in writing everything down in this order. And here I found out, as I began to study a little more about the scribes and what would take place when, what type of responsibility they had other than copying and passing it down, passing the Holy Scriptures down to the next generation. So it's like the Bible. It is the Bible, really. So he had to be careful that there was no mistakes. And any mistakes that were in his writing, they had to literally burn that copy and start all over, because it was very crucial that the information that we read today was written and put down with accuracy. Amen. So he was a scribe. So the verse also talks about that he was skilled in the law of Moses. He was skilled in the law of Moses. So he wasn't an ordinary scribe. God had given him a special gift for understanding the law and teaching it. Amen. God, the key words is God has given him a gift that he can understand the law and teach it. So in the New Testament, what we see is God promises for the believers today, he gives us spiritual gifts. And it doesn't necessarily make the same promises, or he didn't make the same promises in the Old Testament, but God still used men and women on missions, on assignment for his purpose. And he blessed them with the skills, the gifts to attain or to do the job, correct? So God today in the New Testament for us as believers, we have gifts that God used that he can accomplish his purpose. He gives them to us for his glory, not for our glory. And it's still the same today as it was in the Old Testament. So God gave Ezra this skill as a scribe to understand the scriptures and to do it, not only to understand, but to do it, to live it, to present himself in the word as a, well, that's what we ought to do. We don't just want to read the Bible. We just don't want to study the Bible. Our jobs is to read it, to study it, and to obey. So when we obey the word of God, that means we're doing the word of God and apply it. And then we ought to teach it to others. So as we become knowledgeable in the word of God, glory to God, through the Holy Spirit, and I don't want to leave this Holy Spirit out because it is the Holy Spirit that is the teacher for us today. Amen. And so as we study the word, we ought to teach it. That in the teaching to me reminds me of a discipleship. You know, we teach the word. We tell others about God, and that's how we win the lost to Christ, right? Ezra used his skill to glorify God. And that's what we are today to do, is use our gifts to glorify God. So this is an important application for us today. So no matter what skill or what gift that God has given you, you should use it for the kingdom building. We should use it for kingdom building. So when we are on an assignment, and I always say, look for the what opportunity do you have? Thank you, Lord. And the opportunity daily God gives us in our lives, as we meet people, as we go to work, as we walk down the street, what opportunity did God give you to give him glory, to build the kingdom of God? There's always opportunity. And you have a gift. So your gift may not always be the preacher. You may not be the teacher. But whatever gift he gives you, we ought to use it to give him glory. And giving him glory is building the kingdom of God. Glory to God. Amen, amen, amen. I got an amen on that one for myself. Thank you, Jesus. And I thank God this morning for the word, because the word comes to the teacher first. So I've been convicted and dealt with as well. So as we continue in verse 6, because verse 6 is a little meaty, and even though it's small in scripture, there's some things that we need to know. Okay, the king was very generous to Ezra, because we see in 6 he was very generous to Ezra. And one of the reasons to keep in mind that his generosity wasn't based on him. The hand was of God's favor was upon Ezra. And when God's hands is on you, he's moving on your behalf. So the king granted him all that he asked for. And he asked for a lot. So the king granted him everything that he went to ask the king for. That reminds us that Ezra took the initiative. See, it wasn't that the king just came to him. Ezra took the initiative to go to the king. And so the word of God lets us know that Jesus said, if you seek, you will find. And if you knock, the door will be open. Well, Ezra also took that initiative in approaching the king and talking to him and making these requests to the king known. And so today, I believe that that is the kind of initiative God is looking for in our own lives, those who are leaders, that we asked We knock and you'll find the door open. So he took the initiative to go to the Persian king. And again, this man wasn't a saved man. This man didn't believe in the God that we believe in. So there was no salvation then for those who got that. It wasn't salvation, but he did not believe in the God that we believe in. So as we continue, Ezra went to the king, and the king commanded them to move on Ezra's behalf. He went to the king with an idea and returned, and the king blessed him. So what God did, and I believe that what God did, he softened the king's heart towards Ezra. He softened the king's heart towards Ezra, because this is God's will that we're looking at. So again, Ezra's chief personality, as we see, he was bold in God. He was bold. And we see that the king responded to his boldness by giving him all the things that he asked for. And when I was reading and doing my research, what I came out with, it was 100 and all the gold, all the silver, all the gems and the what they gave him, the oils. It was 110. Today it would come to like $110 million. I couldn't conceive that, but it's a lot of money. And so this was how the favor of the Lord was upon him. Upon him. A lot of background. So the main theme of Ezra book was the hand of the Lord. God was blessing him. So the hand of the Lord was upon him, and it was providential, moving behind the scene and moving in the hearts of the political leaders in order to accomplish his plan and his purpose. And so today, God does that today as well. And that's why today we have to be careful when we don't understand. When we don't understand why certain leaders are in place, I mean, from the White House, and this is not just in our country or nation, it's in other nations, while we have leaders that are there, that leader cannot sit in that position without God allowing him to sit there. And we have to understand that God has a plan for the nations, and he has a purpose for allowing everything which we see going on, whether it looks like chaos or not. God knows all. God is still on the throne. God still rules. He rules over the kings. He rules over the presidents. He's the ruler. So nothing goes by without God not knowing. The problem is that we don't understand. And when we don't understand, and we're fleshly people, we're spiritual beings operating in the flesh, we don't understand, so we complain about it. And we say, oh, this is going on, and this, look what's happening. But God said, he don't take orders from us. Amen? He don't take orders from us. He does what he has to do. But this is why it's so important for believers to pray. Because when we pray, we get a better understanding. Because remember, it's communicating with God. It's relationship with God. Oh, come on. We know God can talk to you. God fellowships with us. And he will give you an understanding, at least enough that you can understand what's happening. So we have to understand, yet when we don't, we see the chaos, we see things going on, our God is still sovereign. He still controls. He allows every politician, political leader, he allows every elected official who's in power. He has allowed those people to do what they do. in their position in order to accomplish his perfect will. And again, I said, we don't know his will. So that's why we ought to pray. So we have to always remember that God is in control. Verse 7 reads, some of the Israelites, including priests, Levites, musicians, gatekeepers, and temple service, also came up to Jerusalem in the seventh year of King Artaxerxes. Okay, here we see he brought a group of people returning with him. These were people who were already serving the Lord. So they weren't people that were outside. They were all Jews, but they weren't outside. He brought the musicians. I said he brought the church with him, right? He brought the Levites, the priests. He brought the gatekeepers. So he brought the church with him. Chapter 8. Ezra arrived in Jerusalem in the fifth month, seventh year of the king. He had begun his journey from Babylon on the first day, the first month. And he arrived to Jerusalem on the first day of the fifth month. For the gracious hand of his God was on him. That's mentioned at least 4 to 5 times just in this chapter. So here the journey, this was a 4-month journey that they had to travel back and to Jerusalem. And, you know, they, again, the time and culture, there was no planes and they had to walk and it was dangerous and anything could happen. But if we look carefully where he says, he does mention for the first day of the fifth month, for the gracious hand of God was on him. So it might have been a shorter trip for him because God was with him. Amen. So they were moving from to the promise, they were moving to Jerusalem. And remember, you know, recall, many of them were fearful because they didn't know what they were going to. They had to leave everything they owned behind. They had to leave everything. But these people trusting God, they didn't know where they were going. They believed that God wanted them there and they went. And so this is the kind of faith that God wants us to have today. When he sends us, he will prepare us and we go. So this is the kind of faith they trust in the Lord. The word of God said, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him. And they said, he said, what? He will make straight your path. He will direct your path. Amen. We serve a God who's a promise keeper. Amen. So yes, we're talking about Ezra, but we're talking about us today. So again, Ezra took 4 months to get on his journey, but God was with him. I'm going to read verse number 10 now. And this is a key verse. For Ezra had devoted himself to study and observance of the law of the law and to teaching the decrees of the laws of Israel, of the observance of the law of the Lord. Amen. So let's break that down a little bit. That is our golden text. Today it would be considered to be Bible study. That's what Ezra was doing. He was studying the Bible. Ezra's character, he set his heart. And the word said he set his heart. How do you set your heart on the Lord? He set his heart on the word of God. So that means, It means that Ezra desired to study the word. Come on, that's how we are today, right? We have to desire to study the word of God. He wasn't required to do it. No one forced him to do it. He wasn't compelled or forced into it. He did it because he was motivated to do it. Amen. And that's how we have to be daily. We have to be motivated, because in this lifetime, there's so many distractions. Have you ever begin, and I'm not just saying reading the word, but begin to sit down and you got a topic, you know, you can ask God anything. Show me about a marriage. Show me about a divorce. What kind of lifestyle should I lead? When you begin to want to study the word of God, the enemy comes and the distractions come. The phone ring and you forget your study. You know,
yeah.
But we have to set our, this is a focus thing. Today, you know, we want everything fast, even in the word of God. We want to do it fast. Yeah, fast food, fast this. No. Studying takes time. And you have to sit at the feet of God. And you can sit there 30 years and, you know, I still feel like a babe. And it's like, what? I still don't know nothing. But remember, the Holy Spirit is the teacher. Remember, the Holy Spirit is the teacher. He's the guide. So, and he can't give you anything back if you don't have the word in you. So if you're empty, the Holy Spirit can't work in you because you don't have anything in you. So it's so important that we live a life that we're studying the word of God, that we put time in our schedules to study. We have to be devoted to studying the word of God. You know, we are devoted going to church. We go to Bible studies. We open God's word and really dig into it as we study. We go to church, yes, we should. We go to Bible study, we should, but we got to dig deep into the word. And naturally, it happens. It doesn't just happen unless you put, let me say this, I'm going to take this back. It doesn't naturally happen. If you don't put anything in it, it won't happen. So you have to put time into studying the word of God. And when you study the word of God, you'll find out it's really a beautiful, 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 the words that the Lord has given us to live by, to it. And we're not talking a perfect life, because I wish I could say, you know, I'm saved and everything is well, but the process of in this, and we're not talking about process today, but there's a process of trial, tribulations, ups and downs, hardship. Oh my God, I can't even explain. I mean, like, it's just, it can be overwhelming, but I give God the glory for his word. His word is true. It will not return void. And if we're focused on him, we will hold out to the end. So we need the word. And Ezra was dedicated. He was dedicated to studying the word. And that is what we ought to do. But then Ezra didn't just want to study the word of God. Ezra wanted to live the word of God. After he studied it, he wanted to practice the word of God. That's the word. Practice the word of God. So what use is it that you study? And there are a lot of people out there that study the word of God. They quote the scriptures. They embarrass me. They quote the scriptures, but they haven't practiced it. And they don't have the spirit of the Lord within them. So then that's a whole different. He studied the word of God, and then he practiced the word of God. What's practice? Is being obedient to the word of God. It's being obedient to what God said. Amen. And I urge everyone today is to don't let those distractions interfere with what you have to do. I heard someone this week said, man, I go to Bible class. I'm going here on Monday. I'm going here on Tuesday. I'm going, and I'm not going to let anything distract me. That's the kind of zeal that we need to have. That's the kind of zeal Ezra had. You know, and then after they study in and go into Bible studies, come on, I got to stand up and live that word. Got to live that word. We didn't say perfect now, but we got to live that word. And then as we live the word, you want to share with other people the word of God. You know, we want to encourage them. I always say sort of like it's what he did was he was teaching the word of God and he lived the word of God, but teaching it after you studied and after you live the word, then you can teach it and your lifestyle becomes part of the word of God. Amen. And so this is who we're studying, Ezra. So I just want to just, again, chapter 10 is really talking about the study of the law of the Lord that Ezra did. And we have to always remember the Spirit of the Lord was upon him, and really God's hands was on him. So as I go into chapter 23, I don't want to leave anything out, because this was such a good chapter. Verse 10 was so good. I want to remind you that 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show yourself approved. A workman need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And realizing that it's a great privilege. It's so much treasure inside of the word of God. The word of God will reveal itself to you. And that's why it's so important. You know, God gave us he left us a blueprint. You know, he left us his word. That's the love of God. We could have been running around here like, no, we don't know what to do. No, he gave us his word. And the word becomes alive when you read it and when you study it. You know, we serve a God who knows about everything. He's infinite. You can't even comprehend him. He's so deep. But he chose to reveal himself to us through the scriptures. Hallelujah. He chose, you know, this is what he chose to do. God wants to reveal himself. How do I reveal myself? Read the word of God. The word of God will inspire you. He breathed on this word. This word is a treasure, and it's our responsibility to pick up this word and read it diligently. Amen, amen, and amen. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. So Ezra set his heart on the word of God. And his goal was to live the word of God. So when you study, ask God the question. The questions that you don't want to ask your friend. Ask God the real question. And watch God answers you. He will answer your question. So God is not short of his response. So we're going to go into 23. Whatever the God of heaven has prescribed, let it be done with diligence. For the temple of God of heaven, why should his wrath fall on the realm of the king of his sons? You are also to know that you have no authority to impose taxes, tributes, and duties on any of the priests, Levites, musicians, gatekeepers, temple service, or other workers at the house of God. So, here we see here, the king, and I said to you, this king is a pagan king, but he recognized the king of Israel with high regards. He knew that our God, and I love this, our God had the power. So he had told Ezra, he gave Ezra a command. He told him, the priests, those that work in the household of God, and these were the Levites, the musician, the priests, the gatekeepers, and the servants. And to mind you, the servants were many servants. These servants also, they just wasn't regular servants. They gave their lives to the temple and to the Levites. They served. So they were not to be taxed. They were excluded for taxes. Amen. And so 25 and 26, and you, Ezra, in accordance with the wisdom of God, which you propose, appoint magistrates and judges to the administrator, justice to all the people of Trans-Ephraimites, all who the law of your God, and you are to teach any who do not know them, That's our responsibility. We are teachers. We all are teachers. If you study the word, you're a teacher. It's not just the pastor responsibility. We are to teach the word. And teaching the word don't mean you sit down and say, well, let's go one by one. But you teach the word, and we teach it through our lifestyle. So whosoever does not obey the law of your God and the law of the king must surely be punished by death, banishment, confiscation of properties, and imprisonment. He gave Ezra authority. Ezra had authority. Ezra had power. I mean, he had power. He gave Ezra power to judge people, even to the point of punishment. Come on, he had power. He says that those according to the law and according to what he deemed was right. Ezra was given much power and much authority. You can't get that unless the Lord of God's hand was upon him. Amen. So in conclusion, I just want to thank everyone. I tried to bring the lesson from the Old Testament and into application into our lives today. You know, we as teachers and myself are held to a higher standard in terms of how we are to represent God. Amen. And so I want to just say that the teaching and preaching has power to change lives, to transform our lives, to change a nation. If we study the word of God, we have that power. That's the power of the word of God. That is why we ought to pray for our politicians. Amen. We have to pray in our homes. Amen. Because, you know, we get that doubt where, well, I've been doing it for a while. Keep doing it. Because God is not short of his word. The word of God comes to transform lives. Transform lives that we may do kingdom business. Kingdom business is God's business. It's building up the kingdom. Hallelujah. And it is a process, but you can't be in the process unless you start. See, we can talk process and you never jumped in, but we got to jump into the word of God. Just don't be a person that sit there and memorize scripture and scripture. I know, no, I know. But when it got to affect your life, it got to change your heart, you know, prick your heart a little bit and prick your mind. And it's okay to get convicted. It's okay to get chastised because that's what the word come. I mean, I'm beat down a lot. I just told you the truth. I get beat down a lot through the word. It's conviction. But I thank God for the conviction to get me back in order with him. Hallelujah. So I give God the glory. I pray that there was something that was said. I'm a work being done by the Lord, but I just thank God for you and you this morning. May God bless you. May he ever keep you. Study the word of God. If you just do a scripture one by one, just keep God focused. Amen. I'm going to turn it over to Sister Brenda Foreman. And if she's not here, good morning, Sister Foreman.
The pastor's on.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, Reverend Hawkins. How are you? Okay.
God bless you.
God bless you.
You are our facilitator teacher this morning, Sister Joni. You did a great job in sharing and explaining and revealing the word of God to us. And we are blessed. We recognize our superintendent, Sister Hill, and to all the facilitators, Christian Education Director, Sister Foreman, and all those that's on the line this morning. We ought to rejoice in the study of God's word. This book, the book of Ezra, is the 10th book of the 12 books of history. Yeah, Ezra is the 10th book in the section of the Bible we call history. And you know, you have to know his story in order to tell history, you know. So Ezra is a perfect example of one who studied the law of Moses and the laws, the commandments, the statute, the ordinances of God. And he was able to share it with that present generation in which he lived. And the reason why you need a man of God like Ezra, the priest, the scribe, is because if you don't know the history, you're subject to repeat it. You're subject to make the same erroneous mistakes. as the previous generation, and we know when you look in the background of this lesson that Israel had fallen, that's why they were taken into captivity, just because of disobedience to God's word. Amen. And so God said, if you did certain things, or if you didn't do certain things, that, you know, he was long suffering, but also he was chastening his people as a nation. And if you look at the history, the northern kingdom, idolatry, paganistic lifestyle had fallen by the wayside. And then ultimately the southern kingdom, Judah, Benjamin, had fallen, and God allowed them to go into captivity under the at that time, the background of our lesson was Nebuchadnezzar. You know, he came into Babylon and took the people and the things of God's house, all of the king's palaces and the temple vessels, took all that into captivity. And it was prophetically said that it would happen. And so when you look at the king Artaxerxes, we thank God. I want to just point this out, that God can use outsiders, non-believers, pagan, as Joni was saying. You know, all our help, our main help, the source of our main help comes from the Lord. But God can touch the hearts of, you know, we might say non-believers and government officials and people in high places. Yes, yes, to assist in our resources. And I see that, you know, even in some of our government officials, it prays to have a godly president. It prays to live in a land or a kingdom that your leader is godly. And even if he's not, at least he has some respect for your God. Even if he may not worship your God, at least he has some respect and honor for your God. It works in your favor. And God has a way of touching. And people, what we really don't realize, and when you look, do a little background,
yes,
this didn't start with Artaxerxes. If you move further down the line, it started with Cyrus, king of the Medes, the Median king, as he took over from the Babylonian kingdom, Cyrus. And some studies say that he might have been the grandson of Esther, and who taught him the law of her God, you know, the language and the love of her God, the God of Israel. So at least Cyrus, the Persian king, had some honor and respect. And if you look at the history, EZRA was the second person to return back the exiles back to Jerusalem. Zerubbabel was the first. He went back to restore the later foundations for the temple. Amen. To start the work on the rebuild of Jerusalem. And Cyrus gave him everything that he needed, all the resources, you know. So sometimes we have to connect the dots, but God was in the midst of everything. And that's what I wanted to see. Sometimes we, the divine hand of God, the providential hand of God, even though his name may not be mentioned, but God's hand is moving. And we ought to recognize that even in our lives, that how God's hand moves and provide ways for us. And then the third person to return in exile was Nehemiah. The primary goal of EZRA life, as described, was to study the word, study, then to do it, to live the life, amen, and then to teach the word of God, amen. You know, it's one thing to, people will follow you quicker by what you, how you live than what you, and by what you do than what you say. But EZRA was the primary example of how we ought to study the word, live the word, and then share the word, teach the word. Amen. He was the primary focus. And I want to say this, that in every family, we ought to have a priest. Amen. You ought to, if you don't, are you the one in your family? Are you the EZRA in your family who studied the word, who lived the word, and then share the word, develop and teach the word? Amen. Every household should have a priest, EZRA. Every church, amen, should have a congregation, should have an EZRA, whether it be the pastor. The pastor should be the main one, amen. But it doesn't just stop with the pastor. It could be every preacher should be an EZRA mindset. Every deacon should have a EZRA in that ministry. The Christian education department should have members, amen, who have EZRA-likeness in their lifestyle, teaching the word, living the word, sharing the word, amen, giving understanding of the word, amen, should have EZRA's abilities and spirit within them, knowing, doing, and explaining the word of God. And Ezra's role was to rebuild the temple, to restore worship in the temple. And this lesson shows that there are certain offices. Amen. We thank God for the offices. And Ezra said, I'm going back, but I need to have some folk with me. Amen. Amen. I need some priests. I need the priests. I need the gatekeepers. You know, I need the musicians. Amen. So we don't just do it by ourselves. There are people that's needed for the household of God, the temple of God, to go forward. Amen. And another thing I want to share, the difference between Zerubbabel and Ezra, and they had the permission to go back to return to Jerusalem. But, you know, Ezra talked to the king all about his God and how the hand of the Lord was upon him. But what happened with Ezra and Zerubbabel is that they took the long way back to Jerusalem. They traveled the long distance. That's why it took them 3.5 months or 4 months to get back to Jerusalem, because, he talked about his God, but he didn't ask the king for protection. Amen. He didn't ask the king for the armies of the Babylonian armies or the Persian armies to accompany him. So I figured if the king said, if your God do all this, he's able to protect you going through enemy territory. And so on this journey, even though it's not in a lesson, I think in chapter 8, you know, he prayed. Ezra was a praying man. It wasn't an easy journey because they had to travel through some enemy territory, but the hand of his God was upon him, was with him. Amen. Amen. Now, the difference between Zerubbabel and Ezra and Nehemiah was the cupbearer. He said, I'm getting letters and I'm not going to take 3 months to get back to Jerusalem or 4 months to get back to Judah. I'm going straight through enemy territory. Because I have letters from the king. Amen. Amen. And, you know, last but not least, we ought to search our spiritual genealogies and our families. You know, as the introduction of our lesson, it talks about his lineage. Amen. And you ought to be able to thank God for your lineage, that they may have had something to do in who you are and where you are in your life. I didn't know many of the people in my background. I was just familiar. Amen. As you look at the first few verses, he tracks his lineage. Amen. I can go through my mother and my grandmother on my maternal side. Amen. And see where your spiritual connection come from. Amen. And go on down the line. Amen. I never met my maternal grandfather, but one thing I do know about my grandmother's husband and my grandmother was what I found out, that they were lovers of God. They was lovers of God's house, and they were lovers of God's people, and they were faithful in their office of service. And that's what I'm connected to from the previous generation spiritually. Amen. As he was able to track his lineage back to Aaron and Elijah, you know, the priestly lineage. Amen. So you ought to be thanking God for your lineage. Ezra, the scribe, he was a dedicated man of God, loved to study, knew and taught the word accurately. He built up others on the word of God, and we have to do that. And as Sister Durant said, by studying and you become well-versed, that's 6B, well-versed. But more importantly, he lived a life. And thank God that we have people like Ezra who love the Lord, amen, who's ready, willing to sacrifice their lives, amen, and talk about the good things that their God has done for them. And you know what, as I close out, Ezra gives praise to God for everything that he accomplished. Amen. God bless you, and heaven smile upon you. Back into your care, Sister Foreman.
To Sister Hill, Sister Foreman had to leave. So Sister Hill, Sister Catherine Hill.
Yes, good morning, Joni. Good morning, church. Praise the Lord. Sister Foreman had to leave, I heard. She said she would be on the train. I did pick that up. Okay. Protocol has already been established. Once again, thank you, Sister Sparks, for that teaching this morning.